Good morning, everybody. I'd like to welcome you all to this Sunday morning service with Brecon Baptist Fellowship. I hope everybody's staying safe in these uncertain times we're all going through, and I know I'll see you all again soon. I would like to open today's service with a short prayer. Lord, we live in a world of change. Every day is filled with uncertainty. We are surrounded by the twists and turns of life. And we often feel we have little or no control over the things that happen to us. Lord, we come to stand in your eternal presence. We come to you to find ourselves, to find our way, to find hope. We come to you because in Christ you first came to us. Amen. Our first reading this morning is from Psalm 47 and it's verses 1 to 9. Oh, clap your hands, all you peoples. Shout to God with the voice of triumph. For the Lord Most High is awesome. He is a great king over all the earth. He will subdue the people under us and the nations under our feet. He will choose our inheritance for us, the excellence of Jacob whom he loves, Selah. God has gone up with a shout, the Lord with the sound of a trumpet. Sing praises to God, sing praises. Sing praises to our King, sing praises. For God is the King over all the earth. Sing praises with understanding. God reigns over the nations. God sits on his holy throne. The princes of the people have gathered together, the people of the God of Abraham. For the shields of the earth belong to God. He is greatly exalted. I'd now like to hand the service over to John.
Thank you, Ian. It's true, God is greatly exalted and should be greatly exalted for who he is, because he is our great King and he is our great God. And so this is a great psalm to lead into our first song this morning, which is Crown Him with Many Crowns, the Lamb upon His Throne. So if you'll join with me as we sing together, Crown Him with Many Crowns.
Awake my soul.
And I just, as we've been thinking about this Sunday, which is Ascension Sunday, that's a great reminder that this is all about for what happens throughout all of eternity, isn't it? And so that should be a great comfort to us in our time of struggles, trials, tribulations, all the other things going on around us, in our joys, in our sorrows. It doesn't matter what it is, we can rest fully in the knowledge that Jesus Christ is going to come one day as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And so that really matters. As we look forward to this week, what can we say about it? It's another week where we get to just stay at home and stay safe and try and stay healthy as best we can. And so that's what we're going to try and do. And as we think about those things, I think it's important, again, that we have that reminder of some days we don't know what's going to happen. Some days we don't have a clue how it's all going to work out. But God does know. And so our next song this morning is I Do Not Know. And this will be a song probably a little bit unfamiliar to a lot of us. So if you like it, if you enjoy it, well, even if you don't like it and enjoy it, you can rewind later and sing it again, because it's got some words that really are good reminders for us in those times of doubts and fears that we have in our lives, that God truly does know what's going to happen. So join with me as we sing this. For us, it's an old song, but it's new to us because it's been a long time since we've sung it. And so join with me, if you will. Chapter 7, verse 24 to 27, where it says this: Therefore, whoever hears these sayings of mine and does them, I will liken him to a wise man who built his house on a rock. And the rains descended, the floods came, and the winds blew and beat on that house, and it did not fall, for it was founded on the rock. But everyone who hears these sayings of mine and does not do them will be like a foolish man who built his house on the sand. And the rain descended, the floods came, the winds blew and beat on that house, and it fell, and great was its fall. And so it was when Jesus had ended these sayings that the people were astonished at his teaching, for he taught them as one having authority and not as the scribes. Well, this little passage of scripture reminded me of when I was a younger lad and our neighbor had gotten a brand new refrigerator. And this was back in the days when they came in a great big box. And you got to kind of keep in mind our American refrigerators were a lot bigger than the ones here that we take for granted here. But my pal Danny and I, we got that box, and then we went down to the appliance store, and we got about three more just like it, and we drug them all home, and all the fun we had. And so I nicked Dad's saw so we could cut holes in it, you know, for the windows, and cut more holes for the doors, and we could open the doors and open the windows, and then we hauled blankets out, and even got a couple pillows out there, and then we had a couple late night, long night sleepovers. It was brilliant fun. The problem wasn't that we weren't creative for 10-year-old kids. The problem was that we had something very temporary. So of course you know what's coming. Yep, there came the night that there was a great, big, huge rainstorm. And the next day we came out and it was all soggy cardboard. There were wet blankets and our fort that had seemed so wonderful was now just plain awful. Ugh, and it was no longer fun. And it was no longer a place to spend a night. And so we had to hang the blankets up to dry, and we had to figure out a way to dispose of all that mush that this cardboard had become. Well, I think about that in contrast to the big old stone building that I live in now. And sure, it has creaks and groans at times, but we've lived through some pretty fierce gales blowing through our neighborhood as we've had the last few days. And so the sheer number of times since I've moved to Scotland that my wife and I have looked at each other and commented that we are so glad to live in an old stone building that the wind doesn't blow away. You know, those builders from 1834, they knew how to put a building together. But you know, I wonder how often, you know, you kids will grow up and some of us older folks have grown up and we so often act like we're just children, not really seeing how what we build is so easily damaged, when the truth is, we should be living our lives based on the foundation that God has made for us. And this is that reminder of those last two verses that I read earlier that said, and so it was when Jesus had ended these sayings that the people were astonished at his teaching, for he taught them as one having authority and not as the scribes. And so it is for our lives. We need to build our lives on the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, as we think about that, there's a great little song that we can sing together. And so as we sing this song, we're going to just sing it and see if we can get it done. My friend Jacob, if you're watching this, you'll recognize your name, buddy. He asked if we could sing this song this week, and I said, sure, we can sing this song. So the song is A Wise Man Built His House, and it's a wise man, foolish man song. And so I'm going to see if I can croak through it. It's been a long time since I've done this, so we're going to try and do it together. And we'll see if we can get it worked out right. All right, I'm gonna mess up the movements here, but I usually do, so that's all right. So here we go. All right, just for you, Jacob, and everybody else watching. Here we go. The wise man built his house upon the rock. The wise man built his house upon the rock. The wise man built his house upon the rock, and the rains came a tumbling down. The rains came down as the floods came up. The rains came down as the floods came up. The rains came down as the floods came up. And the house on the rock stood firm. Oh, the foolish man built his house upon the sand. The foolish man built his house upon the sand. The foolish man built his house upon the sand. And the rains came a-tumbling down. Oh, the rains came down as the floods came up. The rains came down as the floods came up. The rains came down as the floods came up. And the house on the sand went smash. So build your life on the Lord Jesus Christ. So build your life on the Lord Jesus Christ. So build your life on the Lord Jesus Christ, and the blessings will come down. Oh, the blessings will come down as the prayers go up. The blessings will come down as the prayers go up. The blessings will come down as the prayers go up. So build your life on the Lord. So hopefully that was close enough, and we'll have to do that again someday when we're not doing Zacchaeus and Jesus Loves Me. All right? So I hope you enjoyed that.
Our second reading this morning is from Psalm 93, and it's verses 1 to 5. The Lord reigns. He is clothed with majesty. The Lord is clothed. He has girded himself with strength. Surely the world is established so it cannot be moved. Your throne is established from of old. You are from everlasting. The floods have lifted up, O Lord. The floods have lifted up their voice. The floods lift up their waves. The Lord on high is mightier than the noise of many waters, than the mighty waves of the sea. Your testimonies are very sure. Holiness adorns your house, O Lord, forever.
Thank you, Ian. That's a great reminder that if the very floods can lift up the Lord's name, then so can we. And it's really because of the truth that God himself is love that it makes a whole difference in how it shapes our lives and how it shapes who we are. And so our next song this morning is Love Lifted Me. We're praising the Lord. We're trying to get to that point in our life where he truly is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords for us. As we thought about the wise man and the foolish man, that's an interesting little story that I think about that should relate to how we live and where we live. Because the question we've got to ask when we think about the wise man and the foolish man is, what makes the difference? And so James, in the book of James, he says this. He says, if any man lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives to all men liberally. And so, you know, every now and again, I'd like to think that I can actually come up with something that has a bit of wisdom in it myself. And I hope you can relate to that every now and again you feel like, oh yeah, I said something clever. I said something that's actually kind of wise. We all want to feel that way at times, yeah? So, presuming we are wise, and that our lives are built on the foundation of God and on His wisdom and grace, then we should as well have wisdom to pass on to others around us. So, here's the question. If you were asked for one piece of advice to get the most out of life, what would you say? If I said, give me your best piece of advice so that my life is better, what would you say? All right, now, consider that you're on your way out of town on a trip. What do you say to the people that are in your life that will be waiting for you to return? What would you say to the children, or in Jesus' case, the disciples before such a trip? So the challenge here is to say something that has value, something that makes it worth listening to, these last words, if you will. Now, Jesus' last words before he died were, "It is finished." Great words, pretty important, aren't they? Peter's last words before missing Jesus, if you will, shortly after the resurrection were, "I go fishing." Maybe not so important, right? But here in the gospel, or if you will, I kind of think of gospels just as Acts as being the continuation of the gospels, really, in a lot of ways, because it's the narrative story of the New Testament unfolding for us. And as I think of Luke, this book of Luke here, it reminds me of this particular story that they are in a particular place. And so we find the disciples and Jesus just talking together. And here they are, they're on this place called the Mount of Olives. And they're trying to figure out the future. And so for them, it was a place of uncertainty. And it was a place where they were trying to figure out what was going on, because Jesus, who had been crucified, was now alive. And he was together with them again, right? So surely now it was time to set up this kingdom. Surely now was the time to fulfill that triumphal entry that they had just celebrated not that very long before. And now was time to show those religious people what they should have already figured out and show them who was really the boss, right? It's time to cast off Rome. It's time to get Rome out of the picture and become an independent kingdom of Israel, with Jesus in charge. Isn't that what we're looking for? That's what these disciples were looking for. And so we come here now, and I'm going to read for us here in just a minute, from the book of Acts, chapter 1, and we'll be picking up there. And so let's see what actually unfolded according to what the scriptures have to say for us this morning. And so he says this. He says, "The former treatise have I made, O Theophilus, of all that Jesus began both to do and to teach until the day in which he was taken up, after he through the Holy Spirit had given commandments to the apostles whom he had chosen, to whom he also presented himself alive after his suffering by many infallible proofs, being seen by them during 40 days and speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God. And being assembled together with them, he commanded them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, 'You have heard from me.' For John truly baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. Therefore, when they had come together, they asked him, saying, 'Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel?' And he said to them, It is not for you to know the times or the seasons which the Father has put in his own authority, but you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth. Now when he had spoken these things, while they watched, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight. And while they looked steadfastly towards heaven, he went up, and behold, two men stood by them in white apparel, who also said, Men of Galilee, why do you stand gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus who was taken up from you into heaven shall so come again in like manner as you have seen him go. Then they returned to Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is near Jerusalem, a Sabbath day's journey. And when they had entered, they went into the upper room where they were staying, Peter, James, John, and Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James the son of Alphaeus, and Simon the Zealot, and Judas the son of James. These all continued with one accord in prayer and supplication with the women, and Mary the mother of Jesus, and with his brothers. So now we see this passage unfold for us here, don't we? We see this angst these disciples were feeling. We should get a sense that within them was something that was churning, that they were saying, you know, it's amazing that Jesus has come back from the dead. But now what? What's the next step? What's the next thing? And I think in a lot of ways there should be some of that that we sense as well in our present circumstances, don't we? We're in a situation where the question has been, well, when do we get to be free again? When do we get to go out and hang out with our friends? When can we go to the park and have a picnic? When can we do, right? Well, now we have, finally, at long last, there's a plan, there's a way forward. And these disciples were wondering the same thing. What's the plan? What's the way forward? What's going to happen next? Well, the logical thing in their case was, just ask Jesus. And so they ask him, when are you going to do this kingdom thing? I mean, after all, when, Jesus, are you going to be king? And oh, by the way, we're the disciples. We're the apostles. We'll be important. But maybe they weren't thinking that so much. They were just thinking about, when is the next step going to happen? And we feel the same way. And I sometimes ask myself, you know, and I feel like, boy, Jesus, if you would just show up and set up that kingdom, this whole COVID thing would be over with. And then I can see, and I can do, and I can, right? And so to us, like he did his disciples, he just says, what? Aren't you listening to me? Didn't you hear what I just said? I just told you, you guys, stay put and see what I'm going to do. Listen, and I'll tell you a different way. And the same thing is true for us. And these disciples must have been asking themselves, well, did we miss it? Here we are with Jesus on the Mount of Olives, and Jesus just said, stay put? That doesn't make sense. We're supposed to be active. We're supposed to be busy. We've been running all over the countryside, and Jesus has been preaching and teaching and doing all this stuff to set up for his kingdom. Surely that's what it's about. And Jesus just said, tarry here in Jerusalem for the coming days, because there's something special going to happen. And then he brings up John and baptism and, what's that all about? What's that got to do with anything? And Jesus reminds them, I think, here at this point. He says, you know, John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. And I think back to Jesus' whole heartbeat, his whole attitude, as we're in the last few weeks, we've been in John chapter 14, where he says, and I'm sure he must have looked at his disciples, and he must have said, you know, I told you, let not your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. I go to prepare a place for you. Gets down to verse 15 in our reading, and he says, listen, if you love me, keep my commandments. Do it out of love. And since you can't do it by yourself, I'd pray for you that the Father would send the Holy Spirit to walk alongside you so that you would understand all the things that I told you. And you know, guys, it's almost time. Now stay put till the time comes, and boy, will you know it when it arrives. But since you didn't listen to what I told you here just a bit ago, listen to me now. Let me tell you another way. You want to know when I'm setting up the kingdom? And that's what he said to him. He says, listen, guys. He said, here's the thing. You don't understand when the kingdom's coming, but you want to know. And he says, listen, guys. It is not for you to know the times or seasons which the Father has put into his own authority. Listen, that's crucial. And this is a life lesson for us as well, because he makes a case then. He says, you will receive power after that the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be witnesses to me in Jerusalem, in all Judea, and in Samaria, and unto the end of the earth. This is a big deal, but the disciples didn't appreciate it yet. And the reality is, I've read so many commentaries, and I just think so many of these guys get it wrong, because they say, oh, those stupid, unbelieving disciples, why didn't they just get it? You know, I don't think that was an unfair question for the disciples to ask. I thought them asking Jesus, when are you going to set up your kingdom? I think that's a perfectly honest question. I mean, in the Gospels, Jesus and even the John the Baptist had promised that there was a coming kingdom. And Jesus had preached the kingdom. And the phrase, the kingdom of heaven is like, was not an all too uncommon phrase that he would use before he would start off a parable. So their question really was just a natural outflow of the teaching that they had heard, the promises that they made, and the hope in which they lived. Should we not as well in our day and our time be looking for the more that God promises us? Should it be not as well we live in anticipation of Christ in a physical presence ruling and reigning on this earth and over all of his creation, all the things that are wrong now being fixed? Isn't that what we should live in anticipation of? Well, I hope we do. Anything less than the truth is we should realize that we have a long way to go in a relationship with Christ. Our hunger and our desire should be for the presence of Jesus in our lives. And not only in our own lives, but in the world in which we live. You know, I'm tired of this lockup. And even though there are now steps to freedom, it will still have to create a new normal. That new normal will not be complete health. It will not be complete enjoyment of what we will really look forward to when Christ is King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and he is in charge of this world. Then everything changes. So we look for the answer. We anticipate with hope. And the truth is we're eager for that moment of real revelation of Jesus in all his glory and our own glorification in him. Is that not what we look forward to? And his answer then comes back to them, and he says, listen, guys, that's a great question. But the answer is, it's not yet. It's not time. Only the Father knows what the real time is. And so he went back to the things that were at hand. Again, we saw that focus on, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. And so Jesus says, guys, it doesn't matter when the kingdom comes. Hang in there. The Helper, the Holy Spirit, is on his way. You know, I've been stewing about this since last week, actually, about the whole idea of Jesus saying, I will pray to the Father on your behalf. And then the Father will send you a Helper. I think that's amazing. He didn't tell me, you go pray that God will give you something awesome. He says, I am going to pray this on your behalf. Think about how awesome that is. And so if Jesus is asking us to obey him out of love, knowing that we cannot fulfill that, and yet he says, I will pray for you to the Father that the Holy Spirit will come. Now he promises the Holy Spirit for him. I think this is amazing. This is huge. This is absolutely spectacular. And he says, I have a job for you to do, but you're not going to do it alone. You will not be alone because the Holy Spirit will be in you, with you, inside of you. He will empower you. It's enough because you will then not your might, but you will. It's not just going to be a might kind of a thing. It's going to be you will be able to do this because you will have power. You will have anointing. You will have ability. You will have my presence within you. And what more do we need? And at times, are you not glad and rejoicing? Because he had told his disciples, he says, listen, guys, he says, here's the thing. When the Father comes, when I come back to you, the Father has that in his control. In the meantime, don't worry about when it's going to be. Worry about what you're going to do. Worry about that power that's within you. Because these times and seasons, he says, are in the hands of God the Father. See, I think about these things and I think, wow, I don't have to worry about that. I don't know about tomorrow, but I know who does know about tomorrow. See, that's the whole key for us, isn't it? And so as we think of these things, it should be a reminder that it doesn't matter that we're not in control. What matters is that God is in control. And so the times are in God's hands and not in ours. And you ought to be glad. You ought to be rejoicing. I think how many times I've tried to run my own life and how badly I mess it up. But this is that reminder that it's the sovereignty of God. That in our worst moments and in our best, it is the permissiveness of God that is in control. And indeed, it can be this formation of God's direct hand, but sometimes it's just those moments when I do something stupid. I know. I only do it once every, 10 minutes maybe. But the point is, we got to admit, we do things that are stupid sometimes, and we have to suffer the consequences of it. For some reason, God allows me to do stupid stuff. But he says, I'm going to make something good come out of it anyway. And so God says, these are the things that I will do for you, through you, around you. I am in control. I am sovereign. I have your times and your seasons in my hands. He says, so the times and seasons, they matter, not for our control, but for God's joy in us. We've got to remember that time is a chronographic duration kind of event, isn't it? We go from this time to this time. We set it at 10:45, our service starts at 10:45. And so it's somewhere close to that, you're ticking on the button. At 10:45, the YouTube thing starts counting down and boom, it starts, right? And we know that it will end when it ends. And we kind of guess, will John be short? Will John be long? We don't know, right? But it is a chronological kind of event that it takes from here to here to get through it. It's an amount of time that's needed. And so that's what we're looking at when he says, the Father knows the time. And it's in his control. And the seasons are where the harvest comes. It's where the reward for waiting for that time to pass is coming. And so we're putting in the effort during the time, but God has control of what the results of that time are going to be, doesn't he? And so it's important for us to grasp that, to get a hold of that, to digest that, to make that happen for our lives. So herein lies the challenge for us. We can plant a seed, right? But only God can make it grow. We can watch the growing plant, but only God can make it grow to that place where it's a time of harvest. I was talking to my dad this week, and my sister planted some tomato seeds in these little flat kind of tubs with the little squares that you put things in. And apparently she must have put 3 or 4 seeds in each one of these little squares. And so my dad was outside, and he was pulling these little squares out and splitting all these little tomato plants and replanting them into another little square so that they now can grow into bigger plants. And the reality is, my sister could plant the seeds, my dad can split these up and replant them into other little holders, but my dad and my sister cannot look at those plants and say, now, I've planted you, I have watered you, and now I want a tomato. It's just not going to happen that way, is it? Only God holds in his hands how long it takes from the time that seed is planted to the time it sprouts to the time it gets big enough to be planted outside where they live. It gets warm enough they can plant it outside. Don't need the greenhouses or the tunnels. And so they plant it outside, and it keeps growing and growing and growing. And the bigger it gets, it finally gets to the point where it puts out tomatoes. Now, they're green tomatoes, and it takes time to grow, and eventually they get to the place where they start to ripen. And no matter what we do, we can't make it happen any faster. Only God can hold that in the palms of his hands. Only God knows the times that it takes to put that seed into that soil and to allow it to grow until the time, to the place, to the season of harvest. And so we can put in some cases, we can rush these plants, but somehow they just never seem quite as good, do they? So it is in our best interest to trust God's control in the timing of the seasons for our best good. And that's what Jesus has said. He says, but here, listen guys, the timing and the season, that's held in God's hand. But here's the thing for you. You're worrying about the wrong thing. Guys, I know the kingdom's coming, but it's not time yet. And so I mentioned somewhere in the past few weeks here this idea of it's easy to tell if you have a Christian faith and to judge the level of your Christian faith by asking yourself if you have a desire to be obedient to the commands of Christ. If you have zero attitude of I want to obey Christ, you're probably not a Christian in the first place. If you're struggling with that obedience and God calls you back to himself over and over and over again, you may be one of his children. But it shows the level of your spiritual life, doesn't it? So if we are to be obedient, we need that desire, that hunger for God himself to move within us. And that indeed is the blessing of the Holy Spirit presence that Jesus here promises to his disciples. And I do believe that that principle applies to us today. And at salvation, the Holy Spirit comes and he resides within us. Thus the command not to grieve the Holy Spirit. And that's found in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 30. But here again, it's this idea that the Holy Spirit lives within us. And that should empower us to desire God's fullness and a desire to fulfill the mission of Christ. And the question we have to ask ourselves at times is, do we live our lives in that power and the testimony of God's goodness? C.S. Lewis said, when we want something other than the thing God wants for us to be, we must be wanting what, in fact, will not make us happy. And it is in that moment of filling that we find that power that comes from God, that fulfillment in Christ. And as it comes from God, it comes to enable us to do what God calls us to do. And it's not a matter of us doing what we want and expecting to be filled with power, but rather that the power comes as we need it to do the will of God. Throughout the Old Testament, we see this phrase, and the Spirit of the Lord came upon him. And there's several names that are filled in at various places. But it always was for the purpose of filling, to give power, to give confidence, to do a task that God had for that person on whom the Spirit came to rest. And so we have the Holy Spirit now, day by day, to enable us to live and to breathe the power of God into our world. But what is that power for? Well, it's not to make us healthy. If it did, I'd have great knees. I'd be able to go out and climb the Monroes and the mountains and whatever else I want to climb. It's not to make us wealthy. If wealthy was all about what it was all about, I'd be driving an Aston Martin DB9 or a Vantage, which is the newer version of that. But anyway, so wealth is not on my list. Famous? Well, I've seen my YouTube figures. I'm not famous. I just do this for Brecon Baptist Fellowship, hopefully for our edification, so that we can be more like Christ, more Christ-like within our congregation. And so it's rather what we're supposed to be filled with the power for is to be filled to be witnesses of God's glory. It doesn't matter who else in this world knows that we do it. What matters is that we are serving Christ because we love Christ and knowing that Christ has already loved us. That's why we need the power of the Holy Spirit to do these things. Just earlier, this week, I had a conversation about prayer. And I had a comment come back to me in this conversation. The person I was speaking with said, I feel so ashamed when I come crawling back to God, and that I don't hang in there through the good times and the bad. I thought, yeah, how well I can relate. But my reply actually was, but therein lies the beauty of our relationship with God. We are his children. And a love that works is a love that enjoys the child that comes back no matter what the condition. Children fail. But fortunately, our Heavenly Father doesn't fail like too many times I've failed my own kids. But a father loves and a father rejoices, not in the crawling itself, but in that coming back to fellowship and presence. With us, it should be that drawing of the Holy Spirit, drawing us back to relationship that's filled with power, so that we can proclaim that God is God, and that the people around us see that there's something different than on display in their own lives. See, we should be different because the Holy Spirit indwells us. And the challenge is that too often we seek God and His power in our times of sadness and distress, and we don't, as my friend pointed out, hang in there through the good times, right? It's too easy when the good times be good to just say, I can do this on my own. But see, if we truly get that our lives are about glorifying God and enjoying Him forever, then we offer to our world that purpose of God's glory. So witness wherever and whenever should be part of and parcel of our daily lives. The where? Well, Jesus said it here. He says, you shall be receive power so that you can be witnesses to me in Jerusalem, Judea, and Samaria, to the ends of the earth. Is that the where? Yes, indeed. And how about in our isolated, locked up rooms of our homes at this time? And again, the answer is yes. Indeed, yes. No matter where we go, we are to glorify God. And so we encounter all these spaces at various points of our lives. I remember when my Jerusalem was a town called Waxahachie. Now my Jerusalem is a place called Brecon. Brecon seemed like the ends of the earth to me at that time. But now I think of Waxahachie and I think, oh, that's so far away. So we find our new Jerusalem as God ordains to move and to shift us around. But we visit and we work and we play in all these other places and spaces, don't we? So wherever we go, there we are. And we do that in the power of God, filled with the Holy Spirit. Or we do that in the power of our own self and of our own agenda. Which way is better? So the challenge is, as Jesus points out here, he says, you need the Holy Spirit. And Jesus had told him earlier, he's told his disciples, I am only with you a little longer. And that I have to leave so that the Holy Spirit, this comforter, this helper, can come, this paraclete, can come and dwell within you. And he can fill that void that's left behind by my physical presence leaving you. And so we move on here to verses 9 through 11 here, through the rest of this. And we see here that he says this. He says, now when he had spoken these things, while they watched, he was taken up. And a cloud received him out of their sight. And I always like that imagery of that. Shouldn't interrupt my reading, but that imagery of Jesus just standing there. Up he goes. And while they looked steadfastly towards heaven, as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel. And they said to him, ye men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus who was taken up from you shall so come again in like manner as you have seen him go. Oh, I love the imagery of that. I think it's just absolutely beautiful and spectacular. The glory, the majesty, the loss, and the angst. But also the hope and the beauty and the simplicity of it all. There is that moment of conversation and the disciples simply, as I envision it, listening in their heads as Jesus is talking, their heads just going up. And realizing that their heads at some point they are witnessing something like they cannot imagine. Did they feel a loss or was it wonder? Was it astonishment led them to just stand there staring up into heaven? Was there maybe perhaps even a glimpse of the awaiting glory of Jesus Christ as he entered from this life into heaven, from this realm into the heavenly realms? Well, we only have these few words for us to read between the lines, and I've got to be careful I don't let my imagination run too wild, but clearly there are things to do besides stand there and gaze upwards for forever. They had work to do, and the angels, at least I presume they were angels, it doesn't say that, it says two men standing by them in white apparel, but we presume they were angels. They tell them, put your eyes back in your heads, close your mouth and realize the future truth of what has just happened. Jesus will return. Jesus will come again. So their response to this supernatural event, standing there watching Jesus go up and hearing these voices from beside them, telling them, hey, Jesus just left, but who cares? He's coming back again. Their response was what ours should be. And it's what we pick up in verse 12 here. And it says this, "Then they returned to Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is near Jerusalem, a Sabbath day's journey. And when they had entered, they went up into the upper room where they were staying. And Peter, James, John, and Andrew, Philip, and Thomas, Bartholomew, and Matthew, James, the son of Alphaeus, and Simon the Zealot, and Judas, the son of James, these all continued with one accord in prayer and supplication with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and with his brethren." These are the people, and this is what they did. There was a witness to make. There was a work to do, but now, for this moment, they were told, abide in Jerusalem. Stay put. It was now time to just obey Jesus, wasn't it? To prepare, to get ready for what was ahead. So they tarried there in Jerusalem as told by Jesus, and they stayed in this upper room with their congregation together. And now we find ourselves in this time of waiting, of interacting via various other methods of communication. I spent a lot of time on the phone, a lot of time on Zoom conferences, a lot of time on Messenger, and a lot of time on this and that, and all these electronic things. They're never as satisfying as face-to-face. But they work for this moment. But in this time of quiet, this time of reflection, this time of don't hardly dare say inactivity, because we're all pretty busy when it's all said and done, but this time of different activity, maybe is a way to put it, we find this time to pray. And we should find time for supplication, for that power to come and to fill us, and that energy for our future needs, to get a new vision, a new grasp of what we need to do for the sake of the kingdom of God, don't we? These disciples were waiting for something, and yet they didn't know exactly what it was going to be. They knew there was a Holy Spirit coming, but what was that going to look like? They knew they were to be witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, and Samaria, and unto the uttermost parts of the world. But what in the world does that even mean? Well, there they were, tearing in that upper room, waiting for this time to pass, waiting for that time when Jesus would show up, right? And for us as well, it's a time for us now to reflect and to think ahead to what will we do into the world in which we live. But we can do it with hope, with gladness, with joy, with certainty. Because as we reflect on these things, we come to this great passage in Titus that reminds us that while we do the work, there's something bigger coming. There's something that should just overwhelm our hearts and our souls and invigorate us and make us ready to do what we need to do. It lays out the questions we should be asking ourselves. Are we filled with the Holy Spirit to do this? And Titus chapter 2, verses 11 to 15 says this, "For the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present age, looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us, that he might redeem us from every lawless deed and purify for himself his own special people, zealous of good works. Speak these things, exhort and rebuke with all authority. Let no one despise you." This is an amazing testimony for us to think about, because as we live for Christ, as we witness for Christ, it is his power, the Holy Spirit that dwells in us, that can invigorate us to do the kind of ministry that Paul admonished Titus there to do. Because goodness knows we can't do it on our own, can we? But the reality is that in God's power, filled with the Holy Spirit, we are doing this work as we are looking for this same Jesus, which is taken up from you, coming again in the same manner he left, living for the coming of Jesus day by day, wherever we are. The wisest of the wise said, we are to receive power and witness till he returns. Will you fulfill this as your last words from now till the day he returns in like manner as the disciples saw him go? Will you be a witness? That's a challenge for each and every one of us. What do we do with our last words? And how does that carry us through this life? Looking for the blessed hope and glorious appearing should be what it's all about, because he will come again. Our dearly Father, we do thank you for your word, for your goodness, for the way in which you guide us, for this knowledge of the coming of Christ, that you will come again. Thank you for the fact that we don't have to be in control because God the Father already is. Thank you for your Holy Spirit. May your Holy Spirit bless and guide us and keep us empowered to do what you call us to do. Help us to recognize your commands and your words for our lives so that we can live and serve you better day by day. This I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, we are to be witnesses. So what else can we sing but shine, Jesus, shine? That should be our goal, our whole purpose of our witness is to make Jesus be glorified, that we glorify God and enjoy him forever. So shine, Jesus, shine. Says, Surely I am coming quickly. Amen. Even so, come, Lord Jesus. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen. This time, Ian will close us in our final prayer.
Whatever we face, we do not face it alone. Wherever we go, we do not journey alone. However we suffer, we do not bear it alone. Whoever we are, and wherever we go, and however we journey, we go in peace, in hope, and in faith. For we go with Christ, who always goes with us. Amen.